Hello everyone, I am Janak Awasthi from Nepal. Warm welcome to you all on Janak Lecture Series. For more updates, hit a like on my Facebook page www.facebook.com/JanakLecture. Please don't forget to subscribe my YouTube channel at www.youtube.com/JanakLecture. In this lecture, we'll be talking about the measurement of the bony pelvis, which is defined as the pelvimetry. So the bony pelvis, it is formed by the four different bones which articulates with one another through the different joints. The two bones on the either side, they are the hip bones, which articulates anteriorly at pubic symphysis, and posteriorly on in the midline, the sacrum, it articulates with the hip bone at sacroiliac joint, and the same sacrum which articulates with the coccyx inferiorly at sacrococcygeal joint. And this articulation, it can be divided into the greater pelvis and the lesser pelvis through a pelvic bream over here, which is also known as the pelvic inlet. So the pelvic inlet, it is formed by the sacral promontory, margin of the wing of the sacrum, followed by the arcuate line on the ilium, pectin pubis or pectinate line, and the pubic crest anteriorly. It joins with the similar portion on the other side to form a rounded margin, which is known as the pelvic inlet. And this pelvic inlet, the measurement of this pelvic inlet, it varies depending upon the cases of either it is from the male or it is from female, and there occurs a variation in between the different races as well. And in the outlet as well, it forms a margin of the pelvic outlet, which is formed by the pubic symphysis anteriorly on the either side by inferior ischiopubic ramus, and followed by the ischial tuberosity on the lateral side, and in the posterior lateral side it is formed by the sacrotuberous ligament, and posteriorly in the midline there is the tip of the coccyx, which joins with the similar component on the other side to form the pelvic outlet. And the margin, or say diameter of this pelvic outlet, can be measured, which is very important during the gynecological setting. These are very frequently applied in the gynecological setting to measure the different diameters of the pelvic inlet and the outlet, which we define as a pelvimetry. So talking about the pelvimetry, there are the different diameters. So we're talking about these diameters one by one. First of all, let's see the different diameters present on the pelvic inlet. The first one we are going to talk about is the anteroposterior diameter, which is also known as true conjugate or the anatomical conjugate. And this diameter extends from the top of the pubic symphysis to the midpoint of the sacral promontory. It measures 11 cm in length. Followed by next diameter is the oblique diameter, which is measured from the iliopubic eminence to the sacroiliac joint on the other side, which is 12 cm in length. And the third one is the transverse diameter, which is the widest diameter along the pelvic inlet, that is about 13 cm. So these are the three different diameters which is present on the pelvic inlet. And the point to remember is that the shortest diameter on the pelvic inlet is the anteroposterior diameter, whereas the widest diameter is the transverse diameter, measuring 11 cm and 13 cm respectively. And similarly, the measurements of these different diameters on the pelvic outlets are like this. The anteroposterior diameter, which is measured from the inferior point of the pubic symphysis to the tip of the coccyx, this anteroposterior diameter, it measures about 13 cm. The next is the oblique diameter, which is measured from the midpoint of the inferior ischiopubic ramus to the midpoint of the sacrotuberous ligament on the other side, which measures about 12 cm. And the third is the diameter that is known as the transverse diameter or the bituberous diameter. It is so because it is measured in between the two ischial tuberosity, which is about 11 cm. So point to remember is that the anteroposterior diameter at the pelvic outlet is the widest one, and the transverse diameter at the pelvic outlet is the least distance or least widest diameter. So we can see over here at the inlet, anteroposterior diameter is 11 cm, oblique is 12, and transverse diameter is 13 cm. At the mid pelvis, every diameters they are equal, that is 12 cm in length. At pelvic outlet, the anteroposterior diameter is 13 cm, oblique is 12, and transverse diameter is 11 cm in length. So these are the different definitions that I recited just now. You can have a pause and look at it. So at the inlet, the transverse diameter is widest. At the mid cavity, every diameters are equal. At the outlet, the anteroposterior diameter is widest. Taking this in consideration, it is utilized during the parturition. During parturition at the pelvic inlet, the baby it faces either right or the left because of the greatest length in the head. It is from the tip of the nose to the occipital protuberance on the posterior side. So to cover this length, the baby initially faces either a right or left to accommodate the widest diameter on the pelvic inlet, that is the transverse diameter. And during the mid cavity, the baby rotates, turns the head to occupy the widest diameter at the pelvic outlet, which is the anteroposterior diameter. So the baby faces downward or upward like this, and the baby is delivered. So the baby takes a rotation as it is passing from the pelvic inlet to outlet. Now we are going to talk about the internal pelvimetry. The anteroposterior diameter at the pelvic inlet, it is also known as the anatomical conjugate or true conjugate. And the diameter that is measured from the inferior side of the pubic symphysis to the tip of the sacral promontory, it is the diagonal conjugate, which is about 12 cm in length. And the next diameter, it is the obstetrical conjugate, which is measured from the midpoint of the pubic symphysis to the tip of the sacral promontory. And these are important for the gynecological assessment of the pelvimetry. And the widest diameter in the pelvis, it is the midpoint, extends from the midpoint of the pubic symphysis to the midpoint of the third sacral vertebra. And there is another conjugate that is frequently not used during the pelvimetry, that is the external conjugate, which extends from the top of the pubic symphysis to the tip of the S1 vertebra, of the tip of the spine of the S1 vertebra. We see that the diagonal conjugate, it is about 12 cm, and when we subtract about 1.5 cm from this diagonal conjugate, we get the true conjugate, which is required for the measurement of the pelvic inlet. So this can be measured, this diagonal conjugate can be measured by the pervaginal examination. And when we subtract about 1.5 cm by measuring the diagonal conjugate, we can get the anteroposterior diameter of the pelvic inlet. And the anteroposterior diameter of the pelvic outlet, it is measured from the pubic symphysis to the sacroiliac joint, whereas the transverse diameter of the pelvic outlet, it is measured by the distance between the ischial tuberosity along a plane passing across the anus. So we can see over here the diagonal conjugate, sorry, I forgot to mention the diameter. I mentioned that it is about 12 cm, but exactly it is 13 cm. When we subtract about 1.5 cm from this diagonal conjugate, which is measured through the pervaginal examination, the distance between the inferior point of the pubic symphysis to the sacral promontory. So this is about 13 cm. It can be easily measured by the pervaginal examination. When we subtract about 1.5 cm, we can get this anatomical conjugate or a true conjugate, which is extending from the top of the pubic symphysis to the sacral promontory. In this picture, it is written as obstetric conjugate, but actually it is the anatomical conjugate, or the anteroposterior diameter at the pelvic inlet. So in this way, we can measure the diameter at the pelvic inlet. With this, we come to the end of our lecture. Thank you very much for watching.